Hello everyone. Today I am going to introduce you with the computer organization as well as I will discuss the number systems. So what is computer organization? Computer organization is the study of organizing the interdependent component of a computer system such that it produces an outcome. Computers contain instruction and data. Instructions guide the transfer of information within a computer or between the computers. It also specifies different arithmetic and logical operations, whereas the data are used as operands by the instructions. Now, a digital computer is composed of firstly central processing unit. It is composed of a control unit and arithmetic logic unit. Secondly, main memory, which is directly accessible by the CPU. Secondly, secondary memory, which are indirectly accessible by the CPU, and fourthly, the input of devices. Now, this is a block diagram of a digital computer. You can see that CPU is composed of arithmetic logic unit and control unit, and with the various links, it connected with the various input and output devices. Similarly, CPU is also connected with the main memory via bidirectional links. However, here you can see that the secondary memory can communicate with CPU via main memory only. Now, CPU is the brain of a computer which does all the processing. It consists of control unit and ALU. Control unit controls the timing of resource allocation, deallocation for different components in a computer by generating different timing signals. Control unit also controls the execution of an instruction, which are consist of fetch, decode, execute, write back or memory. And ALU performs all the arithmetic and logical operations. Now let us explain the instruction cycle with step by step. So firstly, control unit collects the address of an instruction from the program counter and initiate the fetching of the instruction from main memory. After that, instruction is brought into instruction register and then sent to the instruction decoder, where decoder decodes the instruction. Then the instruction is sent to ALU, where ALU executes the instruction. And finally, the output of the ALU is either written back into the CPU register or stored into the memory. Now let us explain the instruction cycle with a block diagram, and for that purpose let us consider a memory of size 65536x8. Thus the address bus size is 16 bits and data bus is of 8 bits. So initially program counter get the address of the instruction, then with the help of that address it fetches the instruction from instruction memory. After the instruction is loaded into instruction register, from the instruction register data goes to instruction decoder, where decoder decodes the instruction, and depending on the instruction it generates operands which is fed into the ALU, and after that ALU performs some operation and produces an outcome and store it into the data memory. Now, depending on the instruction decoder can directly send the data to the data memory, also possible. Now, ALU, instead of sending the data into the data memory, they can send the data directly into the CPU registers. Or it can happen that the data in latter phase of time, data can be transferred into the CPU register from the data memory, like this. Now, what is arithmetic logic unit? Arithmetic logic unit is doing the job of arithmetic and logical operation with the help of various CPU registers. Let us explain with a block diagram. Here we can see that register 1 is loading the data in bus B, where register 2 loading the data in bus A, and after that ALU collect operands from those two buses and do some operation and produces an outcome and store it, load it into another bus C. So overall ALU collects the data from different buses and after that load the outcome into another data bus. memory is primarily of two types, primary memory and secondary memory. Primary memory or main memory stores both the instruction and the data of a computer. It is the only memory that is available to the CPU directly, and that is why it is called main memory. It is fast and it basically store where instruction and data are accessed wordwise from the main memory. Main memory is of two types, RAM and ROM. RAM is random access memory. It is a type of volatile memory where instruction and data can be accessed randomly from any location. Similarly, the instruction or data can be stored in any location randomly. So that is why it is called random access memory. ROM is what? ROM is read-only memory. It is a type of memory in which instruction and data are pre-written. Computer can only read instruction and data from ROM but can't override. Exception is EEPROM. EEPROM is electrically programmable erasable ROM where data can be erased electrically. Now secondary memory. Secondary memory also stores both instruction and the data of a computer. All the memory units which are not directly connected with the CPU is called secondary memory. It is primarily used for information storage purpose. That is why it is also named as secondary storage. Secondary memory are slower and cheaper than primary memory. The example of secondary memories are magnetic disk, magnetic tape, CD-ROM, DVD-ROM, etc. Now, what input-output devices helps a computer to interact with the outside environment? The example of input device is keyboard, mouse, joystick, whereas the example of output devices is monitor, printer, speaker, etc. Now, what is number system? And numbers are used by humans or computer to represent some magnitudes. There exist various number systems which represent a specific number in a different way. So each number system consists of a set of symbols which are known as digits. If a number system recognizes R distinct digit symbols, then the radix of the number system is R and we call it R based number system. There exist various type of number system, binary, octal, hexadecimal, etc. Now, decimal number system has 10 distinct digits from 0 to 9 and binary number system has 2 distinct digits 0 and 1. Now, there exists different coding scheme in a computer which helps to represent a text character into a computer. So, ASCII is one of the well-known coding scheme. Here, every character is represented in binary code. Thus, we can represent text characters by using corresponding binary numbers and interpret them as text characters. Now, why binary number system is best suited for computer? There are precisely two reasons. One is electrical reason, another is mathematical reason. Why it is electrically good to use binary number system? Because every electrical circuit has a two state, on or off, or either one or zero. So that is primarily the reason we use binary number system in a computer, because computer is also a machine. And another fundamental reason of using binary number system is the Boolean algebra. Boolean algebra is a mathematical paradigm based on binary number system. It is very efficient in designing any formula of electronic component of a computer, and thus we use binary number system in computer. Now, a number system with high value of R needs a smaller combination of digits to represent a number, while a number system with low value of R needs larger combination of digits to represent a number. That is why, though it is possible to use a unary number system in a computer, still we don't use it. Because if we want to represent any number with unary number system, that the string representing the number will be too large to accommodate in a computer. That is why we never use unary number system in computer. Now, what is the complement of a number? Complement means the exact opposite of a number. Similarly, minus 5 is the complement of 5. For any R based system, there exist two complement. For a binary number system, 2's complement and 1's complement. And for decimal number system, 10's complement and 9's complement. So, how does it work? If the number of digits representing a given value is n, then the R's complement of the value will be the difference between the lowest number with n plus 1 digit and the given value. Let me explain with an example. Here we can see that 72 is a 2-bit decimal number, and if we want to get the 10's complement of it, we need to get the 2 plus 1, 3 bit lowest number, which is 100 in here. 100 minus the value 72 will give us 28, which is the 2's complement of 72. Similarly, for binary number system, 101 is a 3 bit binary number, and 3 plus 1, 4 bits, lowest number is 1000. And if we deduct the value 101 from it, we will get 011. So 011 is the 2's complement of 101. Now, if the number of digits representing a given value is n, then the r minus 1's complement of the value will be the difference between the highest number with n digits and the given value. Again, let me explain this with another example. So here 72 is a 2-bit binary decimal number, and the highest value with 2 bit in a decimal number system is 99. 99 minus the value 72 is 27. So 27 is the 9th complement of 72. Similarly, for binary number system, 101 is a 3 bit binary number, and the highest possible number with 3 bit in a binary number system is 111. And 111 minus the value 101 will give us 010. So 010 is the 1's complement of 101. Now, let me explain few properties of decimal and binary number system. So, decimal and binary both are weighted number system. Why it is weighted? Because each bit position here carries a specific weight, and positional weight increases from the right end to the left end. Let me explain with another example. So, consider a decimal number 2731.5. So first of all, we need to divide this number into the integer part and the fractional part. So integer part is 2731, where the fractional part is 5. So here you can see that the least significant bit in the integer part 1 has a weight of 10 to the power 0, where the next significant bit 3 has a weight of 10 to the power 1, 7 has a weight of 10 to the power 2, and 2 has a power weight of 10 to the power 3. So if we can do a weighted sum of these integer digits, then we will get 2731. Now for the fractional part, the weight start from 10 to the power minus 1, and it keep on decreasing by a factor of 10 if we go from the left side to the right side. So if we have any bit after 5, then that bit will have a weightage of 10 to the power minus 2. So how we can convert this fractional part 5 into corresponding decimal representation? We just need to multiply its weightage with it. So 5 into 10 to the power minus 1 will give a 0.5. So 0.5 is the corresponding decimal represent value of the fractional part. So if we can now add the integer part with the fractional part, we will get the whole number, which is 2731.5. Now in case of binary, let us assume the binary number is 101.01. So 101 is the integer part and 0.01 is the fractional part. Now for the integer part, that 101, the least significant one has a weightage of 2 to the power 0, next 0 has a weightage of 2 to the power 1, and 1 has a weightage of 2 to the power 2. So if we can do a weighted sum, then we will get the corresponding decimal number, which is here is 5. Now for the fractional part, there is a two value, 0 and 1. So the leftmost 0 will have a weightage of 2 to the power minus 1. So the weightage of weightage start from 2 to the power minus 1, and it keep on decreasing by a factor of 2 if we go from the left to right. So 0 will have a weightage of 2 to the power minus 1, where the next 1 will have a weightage of 2 to the power minus 2. So now if we want to represent 01 into a decimal, then we need to do the weighted sum of the fractional bits, and we will get 0.25. So 0.25 is the corresponding decimal representation of the fractional part. Now if we add the integer part with the fractional part, we will get the whole value, which in decimal system is 5.25. Converting decimal number into a binary number. So for that, let us consider an example. 43.625 is a decimal number which you want to convert into a binary number. Now for that the decimal number 43.625 has an integer part 43 and a fractional part 0.625. Now for the integer part 43, we need to keep on dividing this number by 2 and storing the remainder in a stack. So here 43 by 2 quotient 21 remainder 1, then the quotient 21 will be divided by 2, which will generate quotient 10 remainder 1. Then 10 by 2 cosine 5 remainder 0, 5 by 2 cosine 2 remainder 1, 2 by 2 cosine 1 remainder 0, 1 by 2 cosine 0 remainder 1. When cosine will become 0, we'll stop. And as we are storing the remainder in a stack, so obviously the lastly generated remainder will be printed first and fastly generated remainder will be printed last. So the corresponding binary representation of 43 will be 101011. Similarly, for the fractional part, we need to multiply the fractional part by 2 and we need to keep on storing the integer term into a queue. So 0.625 into 2 will give 1.250. Then 1.250, the one integer part will be stored in a queue, and 0.250 fractional part will again be multiplied with 2, which will give us 0.500. So 0 is the integer term here, again we will store in a queue, and 0.500 is the fractional part, which we again multiply by 2 and it will give 1.0. So the last one, the generated integer term, will again be stored in a queue and the fractional part is 0. So when the fractional part will become 0, we'll stop. So now as we are storing the integer terms in a queue, so obviously the firstly generated integer term will be printed first and lastly generated integer term will be printed last. So here the corresponding binary representation will be 101. Now if we can club the binary representation of integer part and the binary representation of the fractional part, we'll get the whole binary representation of the decimal number. Now what is hexadecimal number? It is a number system consists of 16 different symbols from 0 to 9 and after that A, B, C, D, E, F, which represent 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 respectively. Now how to convert a hexadecimal number into a decimal number? For that purpose, let us consider an example where 1, 2, F, A is a hexadecimal number and all we need to do is to do a weighted sum over. But here weightage will be what? A will be multiplied with the 16 to the power 0, where 16 is the radix of the number system. Similarly, F will be multiplied with 16 to the power 1, 2 will be multiplied with 16 to the power 2, and 1 will be multiplied with 16 to the power 3. And if we can do the weighted sum over, we will get the corresponding decimal number, which is 4858. Now how to convert a decimal number into hexadecimal number? It is similar to decimal to binary conversion. Instead of 2, we will divide the number by 16 in here. So if the decimal number is 892, firstly we will divide it by 16, so we will get the quotient 55 and the remainder C. Again, if we divide it 55 by 16, we will get quotient 3, remainder 7. Then if we divide it 3 by 16, we will get quotient 0 and remainder 3. So when the quotient will become 0, we will stop there. And here also we are storing the remainder in a stack. So obviously, we will print the lastly generated remainder first and consequently the firstly generated remainder last. Because it is an integer number. So obviously, the corresponding hexadecimal representation will be 37C. Now let us show you how to convert a binary number into hexadecimal number. So it is a very easy conversion, but first of all we need to convert a binary number to make it a multiple of 4. So whatever be the size of the binary number, we need to make the size of that binary number multiple of 4. Here in this example, we have considered a binary number which has a size 14. Now we need to make it a multiple of 4. So we have appended 2 0 in the leftmost position. So now the size of this binary number is 16. Now we need to group them into 4s from the right to left. And after that, each 4 binary representation we need to convert back into the hexadecimal representation. and we will get the corresponding hexadecimal number. Here in this case 34EB is the corresponding hexadecimal representation. Now let us show you how to do the binary arithmetic. So firstly I will explain binary addition. So if two bits are 0 and 0, then 0 plus 0 sum will be 0 and carry will also be 0. For 0 1 sum will be 1, carry will be 0. For 1 0 sum will be 1, carry will be 0. For 1 1 it will generate a carry 1 and sum will be 0. It is similar to the decimal number system. If we add 9 plus 1, so 9 plus 1 output is basically 0 and 1 carry, and 1 0 is 10. Similarly, in binary number system also, 1 plus 1 is actually the sum is 0 and it produces a carry 1. Now let me explain the binary subtraction. So in case of subtraction 0 minus 0, the result will be 0, borrow will be 0. For 0 minus 1, so in case of 0 minus 1, result will be 1, borrow will also be 1. Why? Let us consider a similar decimal representation. If we do 0 minus 9, in case of 0 minus 9, 0 basically borrowed a 1 bit, and if a 0 borrowed a 1 bit in decimal system, it becomes 1010, and 10 minus 9 is what? 1. So obviously in the decimal case, it borrows a 1, that is why 1 in borrow, and the outcome of 10 minus 9 is 1, that is why result is 1. Similarly, in binary number system, 0 minus 1, the result is 1 and borrow is 1. Next, 1 minus 0, result will be 1, borrow will be 0. For 1 minus 1, the result borrow both will be 0. Binary coded decimal, it is also known as BCD code. BCD code is similar to the binary code, but there is slight difference. With 4 binary bits in binary number system, we can represent 16 numbers from 0 to 15. But in case of BCD, we can represent only 10 numbers from 0 to 9. And rest of the numbers from 10 to 15 are invalid in case of BCD. And that is the drawback of BCD system, because there is a lot of wastage of bits. But still, we use BCD code in our computer. Why? Because it is very quick in conversion. We can quickly convert any decimal number into its BCD version, and after that we can do some computation on it, and again we can convert it back into the decimal number. And that is why in calculator type of application, it is very much applicable. Let us explain that with an example. Suppose 892 is some decimal number, then we can easily convert it back into some BCD number. Here 2 will be converted to 0010 in BCD code, 9 will be converted to 1001, and 8 will be converted to 1000. And when we'll get the BCD number, we can do some arithmetic operation on it, and after doing the arithmetic operation, we can quickly convert it back again into decimal number. Only we need to group this BCD number into fours, and from right to left, and after that we need to represent each 4 bit unit with the corresponding decimal value. Here in this example, the BCD code can be represented with 9, 3 and 5. Now how to do the BCD addition? So here you can see that 5 plus 2 is 7. Similarly, we can do the 2 bit decimal addition using BCD code like this. Now what happens if I want to add 5 plus 8? Now 5 plus 8 is 13, and 13 is not a valid BCD number, because as I told you earlier, in BCD we can represent any number from 0 to 9, and from 10 to 15 all the numbers are invalid. So how you can do a correct computation in BCD? So even whenever we will get any invalid number in BCD addition, we add 6 with it. And if we add 6 with it, we will get the correct decimal output. So here you can see that if I add 6 with it, we will get 13, which is the correct decimal output. Similarly, for 2-bit decimal addition also, whenever there will be the outcome which is greater than 9, we will add 6 with it, and after adding 6 with it, we will get the correct arithmetic addition in decimal. Now let us explain the gray code. Now, in binary number system, there is a drawback. Two consecutive numbers may be differ in more than one bit position. In binary number system, if we consider 7, then 7 are represented by 0111, where 8 are represented by 1000. Now, you can see that both consecutive numbers 7 and 8 differ by 4 bit position in this situation. Now, that is the drawback of binary number system. If we want to increment a number by 1, we may need to flip more than 1 bit, which is time consuming. And that is where the importance of gray code comes. In gray code, every consecutive number is differed by only 1 bit position. Here you can see 7 are represented by 0100, where 8 is represented by 1100. So that is the advantage of gray code. You can increment any number or decrement any number just by flipping a bit in the gray code. And that is why gray code is used in Karnaugh map and error detection. Now, gray code is also called the self-reflecting code. Now, why it is called reflecting code? For that, let us take another table. So, in this table, we have considered all the binary number with 3 bit only. So, number of possible representation can be from 0 to 7. Now, if we divide this sequence from the middle position, then one subsequence will be 0 to 3 and another subsequence will be from 4 to 7. And now, from the middle position, if we discard the most significant bit, and after that, if we look from the middle position to each pair, then we can see that all the pair are identical or mirror vision of each other, and that is why we call gray code the self-reflecting code. Now let me explain how to convert a binary number into a gray code number. So for that, what we need to do, the MSB most significant of binary code will be, binary bit will be directly copied into the gray code, and after that we will do a XOR operation with the most significant bit and the next most significant bit, and if you do the XOR operation between them, we will get the next binary gray bit. Yeah, like this. Now we need to keep on doing this for the rest of the binary code sequence, and it will keep on generating binary gray bits one by one, and finally when the binary sequence end, we will get the corresponding gray code, which is here 1110. Similarly, how to do the conversion from gray to binary? Suppose the gray code is 1011. We will just directly copy the MSB of gray code, MSB of the gray code, which is 1. So 1 will be directly copied into binary code. And after that, for generating the next bit of the binary code, we need to do the XOR operation between the currently generated binary bit with the next leftmost gray code bit. And if we do the XOR operation between them, we will get the next binary bit. And we need to keep on doing this for the rest of the gray code sequence. And in the end of the sequence, we will get the corresponding binary code representation. So here in this case, the representation will be 1101. Now let me explain another code, which is XS3 code. Now why it is called XS3? Because it starts from 3, not 0. So here you can see that decimal number system starts from 0 to 9, whereas XS3 code start from 3 to 12. Now XS3 addition is similar to the decimal addition, but it has a special property of self-complementing. Now you will ask me, what is self-complementing property? Let me explain with another table. So here we have shown you that from 0 to 9, the corresponding excess representation are shown in a black color font. Now if we do the ones complement of a XS3 number, we will get the corresponding nines complement of the decimal number. Suppose let me take an example of decimal number 2. So corresponding XS3 representation of 2 is 0101. Now if you do a ones complement of the XS3 number 0101, we will get 1010. And 1010 is nothing else but the 2's complement of 9's complement of 2, and which is 7. Now, binary number representation is useful in a computer in a sense that in computer memory or in a there exists a flip flop which is capable of storing one bit of information. So a particular flip flop can have two states, 0 and 1. So similarly, if we have n number of bits, then we can store n number of bits in n flip flops. So it will have 2 to the power n states. So with n bits, we can represent 2 to the power n distinct numbers. So in integer number system, we can represent any integer number in two ways. One is unsigned representation and another is signed representation. What is unsigned representation? In unsigned representation, every number is a positive number. It starts from 0. And if I have n bits, with the n bit, we can represent any number from 0 to 2 to the power n minus 1. But in case of signed integer representation, there exists three ways. One is signed magnitude, two ones complement, and three twos complement. Now let us explain this with 4-bit number system. So with 4-bit, we can represent 16 different values. Now signed magnitude representation. In signed magnitude representation, the MSB is the signed bit. If it is 0, then the number is positive. If it is 1, the number is negative. And the rest of the three lower order bits basically represent the magnitude. So 0, 0, 0 means 0 and 1, 1, 1 means 7. The number range for n bit is from minus 2 to the power n minus 1 minus 1 to 2 to the power n minus 1 minus 1. So if as here the n is 4, so maximum number we can represent is from minus 7 to plus 7. The drawback of signed magnitude representation is the two representation of 0. Now let me explain the ones complement representation. The ones complement representation is very easy. Suppose we have a number 0100. We need to flip each bit and we will get the corresponding ones complement. So the zero of last zero will be converted to 1, then next zero will convert it to 1, 1 will be converted to 0, and the most significant bit 0 will be converted to 1, and we'll get the corresponding negative representation of the binary number. So here for 4, the ones complement minus 4 representation is this. Now the in this case of ones complement, if we have n bits, with the n bit we can represent a number from minus 2 to the power n minus 1 minus 1 to 2 to the power n minus 1 minus 1. So here n is 4, so we can represent any number from minus 7 to plus 7. It is used for subtraction because it is able to represent any negative number, but it still has the drawback of two representation of 0. Now let me explain the twos complement. Twos complement representation is very easy. All we need to do is to get the ones complement of a number, and after that we need to add 1 with it and we will get the twos complement of the number. So here in this example you can see that this is the this is the minus 4, which is the 2's complement representation of the 4. Now here the range is minus 2 to the power n minus 1 to 2 to the power minus 2 to the power n minus 1 to 2 to the power n minus 1 minus 1. So if n is 4, we can represent any number from minus 8 to plus 7. Here there exists only one representation of 0, and that is the reason we always use 2's complement in our computation. So this is their representations. Now let me explain how to do the addition with the ones complement, how to do the subtraction with ones complement. So if we add 4 plus 7, it will do the normal addition. If we do 6 minus 5, then we need to take a ones complement of 5, which is 1010. Now if we add the 6 with the ones complement of 5, we should get 1, and here let us see whether we are getting that or not. So obviously if we add them up, we will get sum 0 and it will produce an carry. Now in case of ones complement, we need to add that carry 1 with the previous result and we will get the final result, which is here 1. Now let us explain another example. If we do 4 minus 6, then we need to take the ones complement of 6, which is 1001, and if we can add them up, we will get the result 1101, which is the 1's complement of 2. Now we need to focus on one thing, that the condition of overflow. So overflow is what? Suppose we need to add two number, and if the number is exiting its range. Suppose if I have only one bit with me, and if I want to add 1 plus 1, then 1 plus 1 result is 0 and carry 1. So we cannot accommodate the overall value into a single bit. We need one extra carry bit to store the final carry. So this is the condition of overflow. So whenever we are adding to negative number, or whenever we are adding to negative number, we need to focus on the thing that whether they are exceeding the number range or not. So here in this example, as we have only 4 bits, so we know that with 1's complement we can represent any number from minus 7 to plus 7. So if we do minus 6 plus minus 5, then the outcome is minus 11, which is exceeding its range. Now let us check how the computer will detect that there is an overflow. So if we keep on, so here first of all we need to take the 1's complement of 6 and 1's complement of the 5. After that we will add them up, and after adding them up, if the final carry and the carry just before the final carry, which we call penultimate carry, if these two carries are different, then there exists an overflow. So how a computer can detect that? Computer can implement a XOR gate where we will feed the final carry and the penultimate carry as input, and if these two are differ, obviously XOR gate will produce an output 1, and that will detect there is an overflow. If the output of the XOR gate is 0, that means both carries are same, and that means there is no overflow. Similarly, explain the 2's complement, addition and subtraction. In 2's complement also, adding to positive number is never a problem. After that, if we want to do the subtraction, then 6 minus 5. So we need to take the 2's complement of 5, which is 1011. After that, we'll add them up, and here we can see that the result is 1, as well as the carry is also 1. But in case of 2's complement, we must discard the carry and take the rest of the result. So here the output is 1. Similarly, we can take another scenario when we are doing minus 4 plus minus 3. So we need to take the 2's complement of 4 and 3. And after that, if we add them up, we will get the result 1001 and carry 1. So obviously here also we will discard the carry. As we discard the carry in 2's complement, and furthermore the number 1001 is the 2's complement of 7. Now this overflow condition may again arise in 2's complement also. So suppose we have a 4 bit, and with 4 bit we are representing 6 and 5. So minus 6 is 1010, minus 5 is 1011. Now if we add them up, the final result is 11. But here obviously 11 is outside the range. Now how a computer can detect it? So here again we need to check the final carry and the carry just before the final carry. We will implement the XOR gate. We'll feed these two carry as input to the XOR gate, and if the XOR gate produce some positive output 1, that means there is an overflow. There is one easier way to understand for human like us whether there is an overflow or not. So if addition of two positive number give a negative number, addition of two negative number give us a positive number, that means there is an overflow. Now lastly, let me explain the sign extension. So if we have 16 binary bits and we want to represent 15213, then we can represent in binary like this. Now if we want to represent the same number with the 32 bits, then we need to append in leftmost position, we need to append 16 bits with all zero values. And in this way, we can extend any sign bit positive number. And similarly, for the negative number, if we want to convert from 16 bit to 32 bit, we need to append the number with preceding 16 1 values. Thank you. That is it.